Thanks, Simone, for being here with us and spending some time not inventing, but actually providing some insights about yourself and your passion. My first question would be actually around how you got started building robots. I mean, you're called by your fans as the queen of shitty robots, and it's amazing to see your videos where sometimes you're struggling in a fun way. It's very entertaining, but it's interesting to hear from you. How did you get started? What made you start building robots?
So I always liked building things, especially when I was a kid. I would always like make little wood sculptures and stuff like that, but then I kind of fell out of it. And I never really thought of myself as somebody who would be interested in engineering and electronics and programming, because I don't know, I was just like, no, that's not for me. But then I started getting introduced to programming, and I had this idea that I wanted to build an interactive website where you could go on the website and use it to control motors. I mean, like a very basic, this was in 2014, so like a very basic like Internet of Things website. And I got an Arduino kit, which is this like little microcontroller kit. And I remember the first time I managed to program it to just blink an LED, and it was like love at first blink. I was like, oh, this is so cool. This is magic. I'm a wizard. I can do anything.
Wow, that's cool. It's nice to hear. I mean, the first time when you started studying, I think you were studying in engineering physics. And but where did you say, okay, I wanna actually really follow my passion here and stop doing this, but really go into my passion?
So it's a weird string of events, but I can walk you through the timeline if you want to, because I started studying physics, and I didn't enjoy it that much. Like, I love math. I really love math, but I don't love math 10 hours a day. And I felt like it was really stimulating some parts of my brain, but I felt like some other parts of my brain were kind of like dwindling. So it just wasn't for me. So I dropped out after a year, and I got a job as an editor for Sweden's official website. And then I did that for a year. I only did everything for a year, because it was like I was just trying out a bunch of different jobs and different programs in school. But then I started studying at an advertising school, and that's where I got introduced to programming and kind of like the more fun part of programming. So it wasn't that I was like, I'm going to drop out of college to do this. But I really liked building things with hardware, and I built this. Like, my first bigger hardware project was I did an iPhone case with retractable guitar strings. So I remember like sitting with my phone, and I had like the charger cord plugged in, and I was just like strumming on the cord as if it was a guitar. And I remember looking down being like, oh wow, this might be something. So my friend Yumatan and I, we did an iPhone case. So you could like pull out the guitar strings from the bottom, you could pluck them to your belt. They had like a little carabiner at the end. And then I programmed an iOS app so you could hold the cord on the screen, and that you could play the guitar strings as if they were normal guitar strings. And I just loved it. And I was like, okay, should I go back to school to study engineering? Should I study electronics? But then I realized, oh, maybe I could get a job and get paid to learn about it instead. And I got really lucky, because I got an internship position slash a job at a company called Punch Through Design in San Francisco. My job was like a maker in residence. So all I did was like build fun projects with their product and write tutorials and like work with their community and stuff like that. And that was like the best school to learn about hardware and about building things. And then on the side, I started making even weirder projects. And that's when I built the toothbrush helmet, which was my first project to go viral. And I just happened from there.
And where do you get your ideas from? Just from like, just walking around and then bing, there's your idea? Or do you have a brainstorming tool or something where you sit down and you say, okay, I need to find now the next project going forward?
No, it's usually, I feel like I very rarely come up with good things when I'm like, I'm gonna sit down and think. Usually I just have to get bored enough and then I come up with ideas just naturally. And if I don't, if I have a hard time coming up with ideas, usually it means that I'm overworked and I haven't like had enough time to just sit and be bored, because then immediately I'm trying to find ways to entertain myself, and usually that's building things.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, one of your inventions is that music instrument out of tooth. How is it called? Out of teeth.
Out of teeth.
Yeah. Yeah, and,
it's right behind here. Yeah. I love it.
I'm imagining how you then sometimes sit there and feel like, okay, I need to play a song here now on that tooth instrument. But when you start building your ideas to really become something that you can touch and you can feel, I know sometimes it's probably struggling, and there are some projects like the scissor lamp that you did on, where it looked very difficult to really cut out the scissors. For the audience, I think it could be really interesting to know, hear from you, when there have been times where you failed or where you feel like, oh, it's too exhausting, I want to stop, and how do you keep on going?
So it can be hard to like keep your motivation throughout a build, especially the ones that take longer. Like, I mean, around my house, I have so many like half finished house projects. But the good thing, like one of the both upsides and downsides of like having building things as a job, and I mean, my job is that I make things and I make YouTube videos about it, is like the YouTube video schedule kind of forces me to push through like my own unmotivation. Like if I ever have a low point in a project, then I'm like, I just have to get past it. But I think it's just like, for me, I'm able to build things that I genuinely want to build. Like I'm really trying to set as few restrictions on myself as possible, and I feel like I am having a lot of like natural motivation to make these things happen. But it's something that I've been thinking a lot about, because like in school we're really taught how to use duty as a fuel. Like you're taught to be very ambitious and like how to keep yourself sitting down and doing these hard things. And we're never really taught of like how to keep motivation or enthusiasm as our fuel. Like, how do you stay enthusiastic? How do you make sure to create a setting where you're actually really pumped about what you're doing? And in some way it's harder, because like it really, you need to feel good to like be enthusiastic. For me, I need to sleep enough. I need to take enough time off. I need to make sure that I'm like genuinely, that I'm not lying to myself about what I'm interested in. And that was the thing, because I used to only build shitty robots. And then I was like, I just noticed that I wasn't very enthusiastic about it anymore. And then just like facing that and being like, okay, maybe I should build some other stuff for a while. Maybe I should allow myself to make furniture, even though for me, that's like not what the people who maybe watch my YouTube videos are there for, or it's not what they came there for from the start. So I think just really being like, being gentle with yourself and making sure that you retain your enthusiasm as main motivation.
That's a great advice. Being reflective also on your feelings towards projects that you have. Speaking of feelings, have you had a feeling of failure? I mean, really, where you said, okay, not because you're not less enthusiastic about a project or an invention that you were working on, but where you said, I'm failing now and it's hard. How did you stand up and how did you get over it?
I think it's, I mean, doing this as a job or like making videos about building has in some way shifted how I see failure, because things that go wrong often become the main part of the video. Like that's the story. So in some way, like things going wrong, as annoying as it can be in the moment, I know that like, oh, that's where the video is going to be at. So for me, failure has more been like, if I'm not proud of the project, like putting out a video and feeling like, no, I didn't like love this video. I didn't feel it doesn't happen very, or that often, but sometimes I'm like, I don't know if I think this is actually worth watching. Because I'm like, I only want to put up videos that I myself want to watch. And sometimes it's like, I don't know if I would want to watch this. So that feels more like a failure than like something going wrong in a build. Yeah.
So obviously all your videos are successful inventions that you made. Which of those would you say is your baby, like where you're super proud of?
I mean, Trucla is, yeah, I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to top that. So I converted, my team and I converted a Tesla Model 3 into a pickup truck. And that was like definitely the biggest project that we've ever undertook. And the most complex one, the most complex video that I've ever worked on. And yeah, she's my baby. I love her so much.
Nice, thank you. Super great to hear all those insights and very valuable advice that you shared with the TechEd, SAP TechEd audience. Maybe to wrap it up and to look at it from the technical audience perspective that we have here, so broad, working on different projects from different levels as developers, architects, and so on. Is there an advice that you would give them in particular in regards to finding ideas and working on them?
I think usually we burden ourselves too much with having a point. Like, especially I feel in the engineering community to some extent, it's like, why are you spending time on this? What's the point? Are you going to turn it into a product? Is it like, what's the value of it? And I really think that if you're interested in something, then there's a chance that other people are interested in it too. And there's value in that. And also like, whenever somebody's like, I still get a lot of questions of like, oh, why are you spending time making that? And I'm like, what's your screen time on your phone? And we spend so much time scrolling on our phones. And I think creating things is always more important than scrolling. So like you can spend time making whatever you want. It doesn't have to have a point. It doesn't have to be pretty. It doesn't have to be funny. It doesn't have to be anything, but it's still gonna create more value than scrolling on Twitter. If not, at me. Complain and be like, Simone, I want my time back. I spent time building this thing and I hate it. And I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. My bad.
Thank you, Simone. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a fun event, everyone.